Okay.
Good morning. Good morning. How are you?
I'm fine.
Hi, how are you doing?
Good I'm doing you. Well, and how
good.
Are you?
Very well.
Oh, good. Good to see you.
Good to see you.
Yes.
It looks like, if that's accurate, I turned my phone off, so.
That's exactly it.
Yeah, okay. I'm sitting here and I turned my phone off.
Johnson, I presume.
Oh.
Thank you.
Good morning. I'm not used to coming up at this time. I lost my place there. Welcome to First Congregational Church, whether you are with us here in person or online. We are very pleased to welcome Reverend Bob Lesh back to our congregation. He's hiding behind that. Today is the third Sunday in Lent, the first Sunday in March, and Communion Sunday. We have a new newsletter. The March newsletter is on the table here and a table as you exit Parish Hall. There's a lot of information in there, especially about Holy Week, which will be coming up sooner than we know. And also that next Sunday is One Great Hour of Sharing, so there's information in the bulletin, in the newsletter about that. And because it's a new month, we have In Like a Lion, Out Like a Lamb prayer cards, thanks to Annie. They're on the entrance table. If you have a prayer request, you can put it on one of these and put it on the prayer tree. We also have our Lenten coloring sheet of the week on the table. If you like to color, it can be a prayer practice to spend some time with the coloring sheet each week. And I believe that's all I have. No matter who you are and wherever you are on life's journey, we welcome you and Jesus welcomes you. Now we will welcome our moderator.
Good morning. In our ongoing dialogue with our UCC siblings from Mitten Egg Congregational, we had a meeting 10 days ago, and there has been a significant change in their plans. It turns out that some of the plans that they originally shared with us about how they're going to bring their congregation to some form of closure and how they're going to distribute their assets and such, those have changed on advice of counsel. And it turns out that the most viable option at this time appears to be a situation where they, Mitten Egg Congregational, would gift to us, First Church, their building and their endowment fund. Let that sink in for a moment. We are continuing our conversations and discussions with them, and we will continue to do so. And we will keep everyone updated as that progresses. But there is at this moment in time, there's a real possibility that we may become the owners of the Mitten Egg Congregational Church building up on Westfield Street in the western part of town. In addition, they will gift to us their endowment funds. And the shape and the nature of our church will change a little bit, might change a little bit. How? Can't begin to detail that at the moment. But for the moment, this gifting scenario seems to be the scenario that is being pursued by Mitten Egg, and we are continuing to discuss details with them, further information to come to you as soon as we know what it is. I will be available at coffee hour later on. If anyone has any questions, I will attempt to give you answers or tell you what I know and what I don't know. Thank you very much.
Good morning, everybody.
Good morning.
My name's Dondi Fiorentino. I have not been here as long as Evan, but I've been here for quite a while. If you would join me, if you can, stand for the call to worship. We gather to share in our love of God.
Lord, open our hearts and let us share the news.
We gather to share our witness to God's goodness.
Lord, let our lives bear witness to service to your people.
We gather to praise God, whose love is eternal.
I will bless the Lord at all times, his praise shall continually be in my mouth.
Our first hymn is in the African American hymnal, number 244, The Old Rugged Cross.
What our hearts hearts can no longer bear, what has become for us a consuming fire of judgment. Set us free from a past that we cannot change. Open to us a future in which we can be changed, and grant us grace to grow more and more in your likeness and image, in Jesus Christ, the light of the world. Let us pray together, our Father. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. Forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Siblings in Christ, let us proclaim the good news. In Jesus Christ, we are forgiven. We are not only forgiven, we are also free. Let us greet the world as people made new in Christ.
Our first reading is Psalm 19 from the New International Version. The heavens declare the glory of God. The skies proclaim the work of his hands. Day after day, they pour forth speech. Night after night, they reveal knowledge. They have no speech. They use no words. No sound is heard from them. Yet their voice goes out into all the earth, their words to the ends of the world. In the heavens, God has pitched a tent for the sun. It is like a bridegroom coming out of his chamber, like a champion rejoicing to run his course. It rises at one end of the heavens and makes its circuit to the other. Nothing is deprived of its warmth. The law of the Lord is perfect, refreshing the soul. The statutes of the Lord are trustworthy, making wise the simple. The precepts of the Lord are right, giving joy to the heart. The commands of the Lord are radiant, giving light to the eyes. The fear of the Lord is pure, enduring forever. The decrees of the Lord are firm, and all of them are righteous. They are more precious than gold, than much pure gold. They are sweeter than honey from the honeycomb. By them, your servant is warned. In keeping them, there is great reward. But who can discern their own errors? Forgive my hidden faults. Keep your servant also from willful sins. May they not rule over me. Then I will be blameless, innocent of great transgression. May these words of my mouth and this meditation of my heart be pleasing in your sight, Lord, my rock and my redeemer. May God add his blessing to these words.
The beginning of a month, we have a new song of the month. Kids, are you ready to learn a song? God is here, God is there, God is with us everywhere.
Thank you.
Do you ever have trouble remembering things? Do you remember when you were young and your mother would ask you if you cleaned your room? You might have answered, "I forgot." We grown-ups still have trouble remembering things. People have a lot of ways to help them remember. You could tie a string around your finger, and when you look at the string, you can remember something. You could write something on a sticky note and put it somewhere where you'll see it. And now, of course, we have our phones. We put all of our reminders in there and hope that we will check them. Being forgetful is not new. The night that Jesus was betrayed, he was eating with his disciples. He knew he would soon return to God in heaven. He wanted to make sure that his disciples would remember him after he was gone, so he did something that would help them remember. As they were eating, he took a piece of bread, he broke it, and said, "This is my body, which is broken for you. When you eat the bread, remember me." Then he took a glass of wine and held it up and said, "This is my blood, which is shed for you. When you drink it, remember me." It has been 2,000 years since that night, and we still use that same way to remember and celebrate Jesus. When we take communion, we eat the bread and drink the cup to remember Jesus and all that he did for us. M&M Kids will be leaving in a minute, and we will have our own bread and juice while the adults have theirs this morning. Amen.
The scripture declares that it is more blessed to give than to receive. The morning offering will now be given and received.
Thank you.
which we do with joyful, grateful hearts. We look at the needs of the world, and our offerings are small. May they be like yeast, gifts that grow in your kingdom, bring a rich harvest of righteousness. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. Impressed so much by all the different community outreach programs you have, all the ministries you have, received your newsletter. I see you in different venues. And the church itself, the main purpose of the church is to go out into the world. And this congregation does that beautifully. It always has. So I praise you for that, but praise the God and bless you as well. The scripture reading from the gospel this morning is from John 2, 13 to 22. Passover of the Jews was near, and Jesus went up to Jerusalem. In the temple, he found people selling cattle, sheep, and doves, and the money changers seated at their tables. Making a whip of cords, he drove all of them out of the temple, both the sheep and the cattle. He also poured out the coins of the money changers and overturned their tables. He told those who were selling the doves, "Take these things out of here. Stop making my Father's house a marketplace." His disciples remembered that it was written, "Zeal for your house will consume me." The Jews in the temple then said to him, "What sign can you show us for doing this?" Jesus answered them, "Destroy this temple, and in 3 days I will raise it up." The Jews then said, "This temple has been under construction for 46 years, and will you raise it up in 3 days?" But Jesus was speaking of the temple of his body. After he was raised from the dead, his disciples remembered that he had said this, and they believed the scripture and the word that Jesus had spoken. This morning I want us to focus on the very first part, the section where Jesus comes into the temple. Many people say that seems to be out of character. Jesus teaches us to be nonviolent and to love one another, turn our cheek, and all those words and phrases that he said. But here he's angry. And he's so angry, he throws over the table of the money changers. He throws the coins that they get on the ground. He sends the cattle and the sheep out from the temple. But his anger was righteous. And the important thing I want us to notice in this is he did not turn violence against any people. He was violent against these objects that symbolized the corruption of those who were the money changers in the temple. He had an anger which was righteous, and there's a difference between our feeling anger, we're always understanding that it's okay to have anger, and there are many reasons that we would be angry in our own lives. The difference is, though, not to use our anger to hurt anybody or to use it against people. So the lesson of Jesus is still to be peacemakers and to be those who love one another. It's a message sometimes people, when they just see that, not. And the other thing is that Jesus is human, so this shows he's got human feelings too. So he's divine and he's human. So those are two things I want to call out from the scripture itself. During this month of March, we celebrate Women's History Month. And this Friday, we celebrate International Women's Day, March 8th. This morning, I wish to recall several women in history as we have thought about Jesus' teaching by word and example for us to be peacemakers and peacekeepers. As a teenager, I had learned about some of the peacemakers who had received the Nobel Prize for Peace. I learned about how Alfred Nobel, a Norwegian chemist, had invented dynamite, which would be used in his family business to blast tunnels through mountains and level land for railroad tracks and roads and highways. In his will, he established a large legacy to fund prizes in several different areas of life, including the area of making peace. Alfred Nobel died in 1895, and his first Nobel Prizes began in 1901, all of them, the six different Nobel Prizes. 6 years after he died. So it's been almost 130 years that Nobel Prizes have been given out. For many people, the most famous of all of the prizes are the Nobel Prize for Peace. Now in 1972, almost 50 years ago, I gave my first talk about the three women who had been awarded the Nobel Peace Prize between 1901 and 1972. They were Bertha von Suttner of Austria, who received the prize in 1905, Jane Addams, an American, who received it in 1931, and Emily Green Balch in 1945, also an American. By now, in 2024, 19 women have become Nobel Peace Prize laureates. And I have updated my talk, so I now give talks at other places, not here, but talks about those 19 women. But I wish to talk with you about five of these women who received the Nobel Peace Prize as our recognition of Women's History Month. The first is Mother Teresa of Calcutta, who received the Peace Prize in 1979 in recognition of her work as the foundress of the Missionaries of Charity, whose sisters served the sick, lonely, destitute, and dying around the world. I'll share with you then some information about her. You probably remember pretty much that she became very famous before her death. Mother Teresa was born in 1910 in Macedonia, and it became part of Yugoslavia. And when she was 18 years of age, she decided to become a missionary and went to Darjeeling, India, to teach the daughters of wealthy Indian families. And then later, she moved to Calcutta and taught history and geography in the Women's Catholic School for Bengali Girls. Now in Calcutta, she observed firsthand the poverty of the people, where many people lived on the sidewalks, died on the sidewalks, and camped at bus and railroad stations. So she encouraged her students in this school, which was walled in, it was separate from the population outside the walls. She encouraged her students to visit the slums with her, bringing food and welcoming beggars into the convent school. In 1946, Mother Teresa realized that she was being called by God to leave the comfort of the convent school and work directly in the slums. So 2 years later, she finally received permission from the Pope to leave the convent. She studied nursing, founded an order of women who would identify completely with the poor, and it was created in 1950, called the Missionaries of Charity. In 1952, the Home for the Destitute Dying was opened, with care provided for all people, regardless of being Hindu, Muslim, Buddhist, or Christian, or non-believer. In 1957, Mother Teresa founded a shelter for lepers who had been forced to live on the streets, begging for food. And in 1965, an order of brothers was started, and the sisters and brothers were allowed to work outside of India in that same year, 1965. Teresa said, "The people who have nothing, who have nobody, who have forgotten what human joy is, who are rejected, unwanted, unloved, uncared for, naked or homeless, these are our people." When she was notified in 1979 that she was to be receiving the Nobel Peace Prize, she said, "This is a drop of deliverance in an ocean of suffering. I accept in the name of the poor, as I believe that by giving me the prize, they have recognized the presence of the poor in the world." At the time of her death in 1997, there were 4,000 sisters of the Missionaries of Charity, 450 brothers in a separate order, and 569 missions located in 120 nations around the world. And that order has continued under the succession of another mother of that order. So that work continues on because of her own desire to step outside of the comfort zone, literally, to serve the poor and the needy in India. The next three are women who shared the Nobel Peace Prize in 2011. Ellen Johnson Sirleaf of Liberia, Lame Bawi of Liberia, and Tawakkol Carmen of Yemen. All three of them received it in 1 year, which does happen sometimes with the Nobel Peace Prize in 2011. All of them received the prize for their nonviolent struggle for the safety of women and for women's rights to full participation in peace-building work. Mrs. Sirleaf was born in 1948, and she lived her entire life in Liberia. During the long dictatorship of Charles Taylor, she sought to increase opportunities for women in public life in her country. Her journey had been shaped by her parents and her two grandmothers, all indigenous Liberians, farmers and market traders who could not read or write. She completed a college education and became a strong advocate for education, especially for girls and women. She was imprisoned by the Taylor regime and then freed by the support of many people in their nation. Following the exile of Charles Taylor, the authoritarian dictator, and then opened elections for his successor, Ellen Johnson, who was elected the president of Liberia in 2000, the first woman president of any nation in Africa. And she was then elected to a second six-year term, so she continued on. She recently died. She led efforts to improve laws to protect the gifts, the rights of women in Liberia, and to seek the conviction of those women who, girls who had been raped or abused, and had killed many citizens during the regime of Charles Taylor. In her Nobel Prize address that year, she spoke directly to the girls and women everywhere, quote, "Find your voices. Each of us has her own voice. The differences among us are to be celebrated, but our goals are in harmony. They are the pursuit of peace, the pursuit of justice. Let your voice be a voice of freedom." The second of the three in 2011 was Lamai Gbawi, also from Liberia. She received a prize for her grassroots organizing the women of Liberia to fight against not only the control of Charles Taylor, but an entirely male-dominated government. As an 18-year-old in 1990, she was living as a refugee in a large church in Monrovia, Liberia. Government forces attacked the church and killed more than 500 men, women, and children trapped inside the church. She and her family had escaped just a few days before that massacre. She had been raised a Lutheran Christian. She first gathered Christian women for prayers for peace and justice. She then invited Muslim women in Liberia to join a growing number of nonviolent silent protests all over the country of all those protesting Charles Taylor and his dictatorship. She led the movement of peaceful gatherings, which led to women being invited to the very negotiations to end his authority, lead to his exile, imprisonment for his crimes, and also then to develop a new constitution and democratic government. The third woman who received the prize is Tawakkol Carmen, young Muslim woman, citizen of Yemen, a nation within the Middle East. And she was selected as a member of the nonviolent Arab Spring Movement, an uprising that was made in 2010 and 2011 in Tunisia, Egypt, and Yemen. She was one of millions of youth in Yemen who were demanding their rights to freedom and justice and dignity from the oppression there of the regime of Ali Abdullah Saleh. These are the five women which I want us to be thinking about this morning. That's four, I've got five. The fifth then is the most recent. Last year, Nargis Mohammadi received the Peace Prize in December of 2023. Mohammadi is in prison, still in prison, Iranian human rights advocate. She has fought for women's rights in Iran more than 20 years of her life. She's a standard bearer in the struggle against the Iranian authoritarian theocracy. In 2003, Ms. Mohammadi joined the Defenders of Human Rights Center in Iran, and she helped imprisoned activists, led a campaign against the death penalty, and criticized the regime's use of torture and violence. She has been in prison 31 years. In the fall of 2022, from prison, she led the major protests against the Iranian regime. 2 years ago, that unrest had been triggered by the arrest and death of a young Kurdish woman, Mahsa Amini, at the hands of the morality police for the crime of not adequately covering her hair. I'm sure you remember that. And that uprising in Iran continues, and she continues to be in jail. In conclusion, these five remarkable women represent a variety of paths of international service and work towards peace and justice. May each of their lives serve as role models to work patiently, tirelessly, and forcefully in our own efforts to create a better world. The lives of each of these five women illustrate the myriad ways that individuals and groups exist in every nation. These women represent the millions of women throughout the world who give their thought and energy towards making peace. May God bless you, each one of you, as you also serve in bringing peace and justice in your families and communities. Amen. Let us sing together from the century hymnal. There is a bond in Gilead, 553.
Thank you.
Christ be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give God thanks and praise.
Let us sing the Sanctus.
Holy, holy, holy,
holy Lord,
God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of glory. Hosanna in the highest, blessed is the one who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest.
We remember that on the night of betrayal and desertion, and on the eve of death, Jesus gathered the disciples for the feast of Passover. Jesus took bread and, after giving thanks to you, broke it and gave it to the disciples, saying, "This is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me." In the same way, also the cup after supper, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." Therefore, we proclaim the mystery of our faith. The bread which we break is the communion of the body of Christ. The cup of blessing is the power of his life in our lives. Come, for all things are ready. This is the body of Christ. Take and drink. This is the cup of the new covenant.
receive the Spirit of God within your lives now and forever. Amen. Together, let us pray. Good and kind and faithful Lord, we thank you for this meal where we are your invited guests. Fill us with your love. Help us follow your example to serve others as you poured your own self in service. And help us by the power of your Spirit to reflect your light to our shattered world. In Jesus Christ's name we pray. Amen. May you discover the love and power of our God for all people, each and every day. You are blessed by the best. Amen.